Hello, Roy De La Garza here with the father of faith, Father Abraham. And Abraham,
what?
What are you doing?
Counting stars.
You're counting stars?
Yeah.
Where are you doing that?
Will you help me?
Help you count stars?
Yeah, I'm up to 710,069.
Now, why are you counting stars?
God gave me a promise.
A promise?
Yeah.
That in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. Genesis 22:17-18.
What kind of promise?
That I will have a great nation.
That you'll be the father of a great nation?
Yeah. And that my seed and descendants would be like the stars in the heaven.
That they would be like the stars of heaven?
Yeah. So I'm counting them to see how many kids I'm going to have.
I don't think you need to do that.
No?
No. He was saying that because you're going to be the father of a great nation that defies counting. I think that's what he meant.
Really?
Yeah.
A star is a massive luminous sphere of plasma held together by its own gravity. The nearest star to Earth is the Sun, which is the source of most of the planet's energy. Some other stars are visible from Earth during the night, appearing as a multitude of fixed luminous points due to their immense distance. Historically, the most prominent stars were grouped into constellations and asterisms, and the brightest stars gained proper names. Extensive catalogs of stars have been assembled by astronomers, which provide standardized star designations. Stars are not spread uniformly across the universe, but are normally grouped into galaxies along with interstellar gas and dust. A typical galaxy contains hundreds of billions of stars, and there are more than 100 billion galaxies in the observable universe. A 2010 star count estimate was 300 sextillion in the observable universe. While it is often believed that stars only exist within galaxies, intergalactic stars have been discovered.
You know, these stars remind me of something.
What do they remind you of?
When I used to date Sarah.
When you dated Sarah?
Oh, yeah. I used to whisper sweet nothings in her ear.
You would tell her sweet things in her ear?
Yeah.
Like what?
Your teeth are like the stars.
Oh.
They come out at night.
What?
Yeah, she put her dentures at the side there.
Okay, I don't think you can say that.
No.
No, you be nice to her. She's your wife.
Yeah. And I can't see how I can have a family if she and I are too old to have kids.
Oh, babies are beautiful.
Yeah, but we can't have any.
God also said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her." Abraham fell face down. He laughed and said to himself, "Will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90?
Well, if God promised that you would, and you can't have any, then he's setting you up for a miracle.
Really?
Yeah. You can have kids.
No, I can't. I'm too old, and she's too old.
Genesis 18, verses 11 and 12. Abraham and Sarah were already very old, and Sarah was past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, "After I am worn out and my Lord is old, will I now have this pleasure?"
Yes, but for God, nothing is impossible.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, she had an idea the other day.
She did?
Genesis 16, 1-3. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, but she had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to Abram, "The Lord has kept me from having children. Go, sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her." Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife.
Wait a minute, you're telling me that your wife Sarah, said, "I can't bear you any children"?
Right.
"And God wants you to have a child"?
Right.
So she offered you to go to bed with her maid?
That's right.
Well, what did you say?
"Good idea, Sarah. That's why I married you. You have great ideas."
Well, no, that's a good idea, but that's not a God idea.
What does that mean?
Well, you never try to answer your own prayers or do the supernatural. That's God's way.
We're too old.
Yes, you're thinking about what you can do, but God can do anything.
Genesis 16, 4-6. He slept with Hagar and she conceived. When she knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. Then Sarai said to Abram, "You are responsible for the wrong I am suffering. I put my slave into your arms, and now she knows she is pregnant and she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me." "Your slave is in your hands," Abram said. "Do with her whatever you think best." Then Sarai mistreated Hagar, so she fled from her.
So what happened when Ishmael was born?
He was a beautiful baby.
Beautiful baby.
Yeah.
And God said that he would make a great nation out of him too.
That's right.
Genesis 16, verse 11 and 12. And the angel of the Lord also said to her, "You are now pregnant, and you will give birth to a son. You shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard of your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand against him. And he will live in hostility toward all his brothers."
That's right.
But that wasn't God's promise to you, because then the child of promise was born.
We thought it would never happen.
Genesis 17, 19-21. And God said, "Sarah thy wife shall bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him. And as for Ishmael, I have heard thee. Behold, I have blessed him, and will make him fruitful, and will multiply him exceedingly. 12 princes shall he beget, and I will make him a great nation. But my covenant will I establish with Isaac, which Sarah shall bear unto thee at this set time in the next year."
What did that teach you?
What?
When it was impossible to have children and you had a child and from him sprang a great nation.
What happened?
Yes.
I learned never to disobey God and to trust him.
That's why you're called Father of Faith.
Even if it's impossible, even if you're too old, and you're never too old, God can do great things in your life.
Well, I'm glad you learned that.
Right.
Yes.